Dear ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome to your EFSIM webinar in the evening. So today we have got a couple of known speakers, world-known speakers. So one will be Francesca Maloney from Italy, and the other colleague will be Professor Schwarz from Cluj. So Francesca will speak about interventions, and Professor Schwarz will speak about liver lesions. So I would like to also introduce myself. My name is Professor Klebert from Munich, and I will give a talk about the use of contrast and ultrasound in HIFU technique by using prostate and myoma lesion. So when we speak about image fusion, this will be one very helpful tool for this technique. We have to know what advantage we could use. So we can use on the one side the MRI examination, as we've seen it here. And on the other side, we can also use CT examination. There's an option to upload these DICOM data directly in our ultrasound system, and we could see the images side by side, either the MRI image and on the other side, the ultrasound image. What is helpful? So first of all, you have to make a decision what kind of fusion you like to use. Should it be CT? Should it be MRI? Should it be PET-CT, PET-MRI? As long as we have real DICOM data, everything works. But keep in mind that patient with cardiac pacemaker will not be the best patient to include your trial because there might be an interaction with a magnetic generator. So first, the first experience that I had got with fusion was, I think, nearly 14 years ago. When you look at the left side, you see this image was acquired in the year 2005. It took me 3 hours to do the registration of this image for a single case. At this time, it was only for scientific research, not for daily diagnosis, because 3 hours of registration and is much too long. Nowadays, you can do the same job in a better quality in less than 2 minutes. How it's working? So there's a sensor which is connected to the probe, or sometimes some vendors have got also the sensor inside of the probe. There is a magnetic generator and a control box. The most time the control box is inside of the system. And once you have done the registration, you see on the one side the prostate image, on the other side the MRI and the ultrasound image side by side. There are different layouts available. It's up to you what you prefer. If you would like to inject contrast for the prostate, it depends a little bit on the contrast dose you have to use. It depends on the system. So the recommendation will be between 1.4 to 2.4 cc of contrast, followed by 10 cc of saline. We know that prostate cancer has got a major influence, especially in the man world, that a couple of patients unfortunately die. So if we compare this to the woman world, there's a breast cancer program which screen world. So we also need a similar technique now available for men. If you ask by yourself, if you have looked at the MRI examination, what kind of image of which sequence will be fit? So sometimes if you open a DVD with cross images, you find up to 5,000 images for such a small organ. So my recommendation will be that you use the axial T2 image for registration and fusion, but you can also use BTC or contrast images as we've seen it here. The PIRES classification gives you a good table where it shows the risk of having cancer. So PIRES 1 will be there's no risk of cancer, and PIRES 5 means there is cancer. But sometimes we also have PIRES 3, where we are not sure the MRI is really cancer or not cancer, and even in this patient we have to follow up this examination. By looking at the image technique, fusion technique, there are 3 options available. One is that you have the images only side by side. One, you have got the biopsy tracking option, so you see this tiny lesion here and you do the biopsy. And one, you only mark this lesion on the left side of the prostate, and the marker also show up on the ultrasound image. This is a 61-year-old patient with a PSA of more than 20. In the MRI, there was a Peyret's 4 lesion described. After registration, you see there's the lesion, the MRI, and the same marker also show up on the ultrasound image. What about vascularization? If you look carefully at the lower image, you see that this lesion show not a major vascularization in comparison to the rest of the prostate. And how good is your registration? So there's the option to switch between the ultrasound image and the MRI image side by side. And then you see there's a tiny lesion. And in this case, the registration is pretty good. The next step, we also do the biopsy. There's our landmark, this is the biopsy channel. And you see here the biopsy needle just hit this lesion. And this was confirmed as a Gleason 7A score. What are the treatment options for prostate cancer? There's an option that you could watch full waiting or active surveillance, surgery, radiation therapy, hormone therapy, chemotherapy, or you can also use this kind of HIFU therapy. In our study, only patients with a Gleason score above 7 will be included, so these are most of the time Gleason 6 score. So in this case, I show you the complete workflow. You have the MRI data. You see, we magnify the image. We are looking where is the lesion. We scroll in the axial plane. There we find the lesion on the left side. It's a huge cancer around about probably 3 centimeters. And you see also the T1 marker show up. There we show all landmarks. There's the landmark. And this is the same examination where we do the fusion with ultrasound and MRI. So we look at the border of the lesion, whether the border of the lesion fit, yes or no. Then we look at the vascularization. On the one side, we use the conventional color Doppler. We look at the vascularization. We see this lesion here has not a major vascularization. By looking at contrast, you see that this pattern is a little bit different in comparison to this part of the prostate. These are the planning where we do the HIFU directly by ultrasound guided in the operations theater. This is our planning MAC to do a half prostate lab ablation of the prostate. So here we do directly the ablation. You see these lines, these are the artifacts, use the ablation, that's fine. And then we would like to follow up directly in the operations theater whether we have got a successful treatment, yes or no. So we see there's a lesion, ultrasound. If you compare now to the right lobe of the prostate and the left lobe of the prostate, you see that there is no major vessels anymore on this side. What about perfusion? So we do repeat the examination by contrast. We see tiny vessels here in the contrast setting. And you see there was a prostate cancer, and now there's a big area with no contrast uptake. So pretty good necrosis after HIFU therapy of the left part of the left lobe of the prostate. What happens after 24 hours? So if we look again, there was a lesion. There's a lesion in the MRI. Similar appearance, we see no vessels in this area. Indirect sign for a good treatment. Repeat the examination again. You see a nice perfusion of the right lobe. And here you see a good necrosis of the left lobe. So successful treatment of a prostate cancer. Again, the overlay, you see there was a cancer that's matched pretty good. And also here you see no contrast uptake of the part of the left lobe. Here's a little bit contrast uptake in the anterior part of the left lobe, but this will not have got any influence on our prostate cancer. We have also a second case. This patient has also a PSMR PET, which described Peyret's 4 lesions. The PSA was just 7. So we repeat the examination as you've seen it. You see already here, there's a tiny prostate cancer lesion on the left peripheral zone of the prostate. So we mark this lesion on the MRI. The marker is also shown up here in the ultrasound image. Although this lesion showed no major vessels, keep in mind that there's a couple of vessels before treatment and we show up what happens later. Then we inject contrast at the baseline. You see that lesion has got an atypical contrast behavior in comparison to the rest. The contrast uptake is less and later. In the follow-up, you see in the caldopla, the vessels we have seen before is missing, indirect sign of a successful treatment. There's still the cancer and the grayscale visible, the same as we've seen it here in the MR. And now repeats examination, you see a nice perfusion of the right lobe of the prostate, and here's the left lobe of the prostate, also a successful treatment of this small prostate cancer with diameter roughly about 7 millimeter. Again, you see successful treatment. We also published this case 1.5 years ago. What are the results if you use this technique? So we detect more prostate cancer by fusion technique. We have also often more higher Gleason score. We could optimize our fusion biopsy. And for the hyphotherapy, we can use this tool for the planning and also follow up after hyphotherapy. So we can say directly operation theater whether we have to replace the transducer or whether we already have done a successful treatment. The second part of my talk will similar technique, but we use it on myoma and different equipment. So sometimes if a woman has got a myoma, she could have got pain. There sometimes she doesn't feel good, she could have got bleeding, and we have to offer this woman a kind of treatment. Should it be just watchful waiting? Should it be medicine? Should it be an operation treatment or should it be a HIFU treatment? This is the first patient, a 46-year-old woman. She had got 2 children. She has got heavy bleeding. She has got pain. Therefore, we make the decision that we should treat her with a HIFU therapy. So we see the huge uterus here. We see the myoma inside. On the one side, you see the MRI. On the other side, the grayscale. Same by caldopla, see a couple of vascularization here in the peripheral part. Then we look at contrast. We see a nice perfusion of the complete uterus here and also the myoma in this area. Again, you see, does this fusion match good? Yes or no? So we switch between ultrasound and MRI. You see the border of the MRI images match pretty good with the border of the ultrasound and a complete perfusion of this myoma. In the follow-up examination, we already see that there's a couple of necrosis already in the MRI examination. Also here in the grayscale, it looks a little bit anemogenous. There's no major vessels inside here. And if you now compare with contrast, you see a huge necrosis after HIFU therapy guided by MRI in this area. So we can see these necrosis, and if you follow up this over time, you will see there will be a shrinking of these necrosis over time. Just an image where you can check the border and the perfusion. There's a little bit of perfusion here. We also see this here, but successful treatment, huge necrosis of the myoma of the uterus. The second patient, that was a 47-year-old woman with 2 children. She has also pain. And also we make the decision that she should undergo a HIFU therapy. So we see there the myoma inside of the uterus. Also a couple of vessels are inside here. Then we match it by fusion technique. We see there's a couple of myoma. There's a myoma, there's one, there one. We make the decision that we would like to treat this big one here. Also the peripheral is a couple of vessels. What about perfusion? You see that this myoma has got still a perfusion similar as we've seen it by MRI. If you would like to treat this, you see already see this. There's a little bit in images, grayscale in the myoma now. In the MRI, you see necrosis. Caldopla could not detect any vessels inside. By looking by contrast, you see a nice perfusion of the uterus, but the myoma in this area show a defect, perfusion defect, corresponding to the MRI image we've seen on the other side. If you compare now on the side by side, before treatment, after treatment, you'll see directly the success of the treatment. And why is it so important to think about whether we could offer this contrast agent? Because once you inject the MRI contrast agents, you are not allowed to go on with the treatment. So if you use a contrast agent, you could still go on with the treatment if it was not successful. What are the conclusion? So HIFU therapy create a huge necrosis. There you see the perfusion defect afterwards. It's similar like we've seen it in the contrast ultrasound in comparison to the MRI. But for the follow-up examination, this technique is very helpful. And of course, the risk of having nephrocortic systemic fibrosis is still low. What are the complete take-home points? Thorax offer a good correlation to MRI findings, either on prostate and also on the myoma. It's kind of problem-solving tool because we could use this tool during an intervention and make a decision whether we already have reached our goal, yes or no, or whether you have to go on with treatment. Especially in the follow-up, it's a very sensitive tool which detects these kind of necrosis pretty good, and it has got less risk. With my last slide, I would like to thank for your attention, and I'm open for questions. So the question was, what about the success rate of doing HIFU therapy of the prostate in the follow-up especially? This depends a little bit. So if you do a follow-up, first of all, the amount of patient is not too big because Gleason's 6 score is very low. If you follow up this, we have find in our case study very good results, but you will see over time that the treated prostate lobe will getting smaller and smaller, and sometimes you only find one lobe anymore. So don't get confused if you, one lobe is missing after 2 years. This just happens to the treatment. And in our patient study, we have not any recurrence until now.